Hello?
Hey guys.
Eric.
Okay. Sorry we're running a little late. I'll go ahead and get started. My name is Mike Iverson. If you don't know me, I run a blog called Blind Squirrel Props. I've been building props since about 2005. Doing commission work, but mainly for my own stuff. I got started, probably back like everyone else when Star Wars came out. I'm that old. This was my first costume that I built myself at age 12. Toilet paper rolls for the eyes, and then big pen caps for the little vents or whatever those things are on the same person. And that started me rolling. I went to school at East Carolina University, majored in graphic design and illustration. I drew a comic book in the 90s called Vigil. It was a kind of a vampire crime thing. Did about 1,000 pages worth, about 20-some issues. And then currently I'm working on illustrating the author of Vigil. He's got a series of science fiction books. The first one is In a Flash, which is available at Amazon.com. Thanks for asking. One day at my design job, at lunch, I was kind of surfing the internet, and I went to the Blaster Builders Club. And on there, they had a tutorial for building your own blaster. And, you know, of course, this is something that I've always wanted. The instructions look simple, and I was thinking, hey, I could do this. So I had a Dremel, I grabbed some PVC pipe to base it around, and slowly but surely, over the course of a month's worth of lunch hours, I built each little part, and before I knew it, I had a real blaster of my own with a working trigger, and then the stock actually unfolds. I was very happy about that. This was my second project. I found the actual machinist diagrams for the PPSH-41, which is the submachine gun used by the Soviet Army in World War II. From there, that gave me reference for probably about 3/4 of the parts for the gun, so I could build an actual scale. From there, for the things that it didn't show me, I was able to compare it to the stuff that I did know, kind of reverse engineer it. So right now I've got a gun that can be fully stripped. It's all plastic with the wooden stock, little bits of hardware for screws and springs and bolts and whatnot. But it functions exactly like the real gun, including the drum magazine. And it does everything but will shoot a bullet. That I can chamber rounds. I even did the cleaning kit pocket in the back of the butt with a little spring-loaded window. Or little door. This was a Halloween costume. This was around the time of Halo 2. I started with a batting helmet, and I kind of went low-tech on this. I built up kind of a framework in styrene, and then kind of filled the pockets with insulation foam, and then kind of, you know, sanded that smooth, and then basically just glued more styrene on top of that. And lots of putty and sanding, and but it turned out all right. It's not as good as some of the ones out there, but it did the job, at least for that Halloween. I had about a week of vacation time at work, and so I decided to take a big stack of MDF I had sitting on the back porch and build Hellboy's right hand of doom. So this is the cuff is a solid donut of MDF, about this big and about 12 inches round, which I laid just to speed up the smoothing process. It's all hand textured with the Dremel, and it is wearable. It's got a padded interior and weighs about 20 pounds. So you feel like you're wearing Hellboy's real hand when you got that thing on. This was my first commissioned project. This was a pair of swords from X-1999. They're about 5.5 feet long. And since they needed to be identical, what I did is I sculpted all the parts in clay, made molds, and then made resin casts from the molds. And then everything is kind of built around a steel rod that runs the entire length. This was a hilt for a Tenchi Muyo, Tenchi sword, minus the blade. The first one at the bottom is, I did a few years ago. It's actually hand carved from a piece of 3/4 inch MDF. Real simple. There was a lot of demand for this particular prom, and so I borrowed the original from the client, made a cast, made it a little thicker for the copies, and went in and cleaned up all the detail, and then made a new production mold so I could sell resin copies of this. This is the Ragnar sword from Super Smash Brothers Brawl, I believe. This was one of the first projects that, since the sword is so big, it's about, I think it's about 5 feet long, a real wide blade. What I did is I made the blade out of 2 sheets of 1/4 inch poplar, and I drew, took the Dremel and made a channel in the face of each one, and then kind of sandwiched it around a steel rod. So what this does, it keeps the blade from wiggling at all, which I guess 2 1/4 inch sheets aren't going to wiggle much, but it keeps everything nice and straight, but then it also gives you a nice framework for attaching the handle. So you're not going to be waving it around with the handle and the blade's going to come flying off. So it's one solid piece all the way to the pommel. Other pieces, the handle I think was lathe. The crossbar is probably poplar and as detailed as little bits of styling. I have built quite a few of these. This is the Yoko Ritona sniper rifle from
Gurren Lagann.
I could never get it. It's about 6 feet long. Quite a few of the clients were probably topping out around 5 feet, so it looked even bigger. The body of the gun is a PVC pipe. The butt and the grip are MDF. So that gives it a good amount of weight. The scope is a lathe piece of basswood, which is kind of a harder version, but it's like balsa, but it's harder, really fine grain. Doesn't take any time to clean it up. I use real gun parts where I could. The bipod is a metal bipod for airsoft. A working trigger, of course, and the barrel or the magazine can be removed. I even had a false top with one of the shells on it, and then you could pop it open and put your keys or ID or stuff in there.
Nice.
And then, of course, the barrel completely pulls out and it's secured with a screw so that it can be more easily transported. So it's about 2-3 foot pieces thereabouts. This was a popular project for the site. This was the original caster gun. The client wanted it to be loadable, and so what I did is kind of started working from the inside out, made the shells, and then based the breech around a simple size PVC pipe, and kind of worked from there on out. The rest of the barrel is solid wood, the grip is solid wood, plastic details, and it's not completely accurate. I was basing it more on, it must have been some fan art that I saw, hence the little pipes coming off it, which are kind of cool, but they're not accurate. So later on, I was commissioned again, and working with the client, we kind of noodled it and tried to get it as accurate as possible. So I think I'm probably in the 95% accuracy at this point. This too is also loadable. The breech arm moves up and down. The cap pulls back. I got some high pressure water jet aluminum rails cut. So they're all consistent and nice and smooth. It slides out, you can put a shell into it, and his particular model, I put a 3/4 inch barrel, or 3/4 inch PVC barrel. So once you pop open the breech, you can actually look down the barrel. And then, of course, spring-loaded trigger. And you just gotta be careful of that front and back sight, because they're really fragile. I'm sure people have lost a few of them. This was the helmet, or the helm of the Witch King of Angmar from Lord of the Rings. I was reading a prop builder site, Featherweight, and I think he's either in Canada or someplace like that, is he? And he uses cardboard and hot glue to build all sorts of crazy stuff, just amazing. And so I decided to give that a try. So at work one day, I took some cardboard and sized it and then kind of cobbled together the rest of the geometry, but I couldn't get the hot glue to work. So that's, I guess that takes a little bit of experience. I didn't have the patience for it. So what I did instead is I took Bondo auto body filler and kind of smeared it on there, and the application process gave me a great distressed metal look without much effort. I basically kind of smoothed it down and left the pits, and made some spikes out of wooden dowels and a little putty for the little ring where it attaches, and a black hood for wearing it. So it's pretty easy and it's very light and cheap. This is the Paracelsus key from Guilty Gear. This I thought was going to be easy because it doesn't have a lot of detail, but big and simple is the same as small and complicated. This thing is well over 6 feet tall. It separates at the head and at the key from the barrel. Let's see, the chain is a plastic parrot toy. The shaft is, I think, a 4 or 5 inch PVC pipe, the black ABS. The head and the key is, was built in foam and then just covered in styrene to get a nice clean surface. The googly eyes are a plastic light dome, or like an outdoor light fixture, and I just kind of cut off a little section of it, and then I mounted on a little swivel so you can kind of move the eyes around and make them look in different places. And it's still pretty heavy even though it's all filled with foam, so it's about 8 pounds. So she had some lugging around to do that day. I think she's still 5'10". I think she's still a pretty tall girl, and it was dwarfing her. This is the Bankai from, is this from Bleach?
Yes.
And this was another beast, about 7 feet long. I basically built the body, you can see the seams here. The body is built with a 6-inch cardboard tube that they use for casting concrete. And so the wearer kind of puts their arm in, and then it kind of sits like this inside the tube, and then there's a little handle for holding it. The nose cones, the very tip where it starts to round out, I laid that, made a rubber mold, and then kind of did a rotation molded resin copy for each side. And then they were glued to a part of the concrete tube that I had separated and then smoothed over. The rest of the armor is all heat-formed thick styrene. I think it's like 1/8 inch, and just heated it with the painter's heat gun. The weight distribution is pretty good, but this thing was about 12 pounds. So if you're standing around, I just say, you know, put it upright and stand it on your foot so you don't scuff the paint. This is the Vampire Knight Artemis Scythe. This was another long one. The blade itself is about 4.5 feet long. I sculpted this completely out of foam and then coated it with stuff called Styro Spray, which kind of hard coats it. And the shaft separates, I think, in 3 pieces, and then also from the blade. That was lathed to kind of get the scallops, and then I, with Bondo, I just put the little decorative elements on them. This was actually very light, the wheel rail. This is a scouter from Dragon Ball Z. This is, the white parts are all vacuum formed. I used my little mini vacuum former where I put a little sheet from the hobby store in a little frame and put it in a toaster oven. and you heat it up, and then I built a little vacuum table about that size, about 10 by 8 by 10, and just vacuum formed those two pieces so they're super light. Heat formed the bend in the red acrylic. It's about 8-inch red acrylic. And then the padding I took from a set of hearing protectors from the hardware store, I think Harbor Freight. And then there's like, I put in a little wire hook to fit over the ear for wearing it. This is from Soul Calibur. This is Techie's Swords, or one of them anyway. The blade itself is a, I think I started with a 1/4-inch poplar. I wanted a hardwood so it would be durable, and then just sanded the edge to the blade. The ornamentation, the pommel, and the part near the blade here were highly detailed, and trying to sculpt something that small, probably about 1 inch across, was well beyond my ability, especially to get those scales perfect. So what I did is I built that in 3D, and then sent that out to Shapeways and had it 3D printed. And when I got it back, I just cleaned it up a little bit, threw it in some silicone, made resin copies, and then glued them on the swords. Great thing is, like with the parts up here by the blade, is once I made the mold once, I could knock out 4 copies of those and put them on the sword. There was a lot of handwork done on the scabbard. I think the only parts that were 3D printed was the very tip of the scabbard. Oh, the collar was 3D printed, and then also that little ornamentation near the red part. A lot of ribbon. The little scroll, what I did is I took a little thin sheet of roofing aluminum, and I printed out on a laser printer the actual design, and then glued it to the aluminum, and then just wrapped it around so it always stays in the right spot. This is the card captor's wand. One of the heads, the other one is the bird head. I didn't bring a picture of that one. But this one was modeled in 3D. It's a big piece, so it would be extremely expensive to do it solid, probably $500-$600. What it ended up doing though, is since 3D allows you to work completely symmetrical, I molded. Like if you were to cut away the back half. So I was only modeling the front half, and then I made it hollow, so it's only about 1 millimeter thick. So printing that out cost me, I think, about $70. Got it home, glued it to a sheet of board, made a mold, popped that open, made 2 copies, glued them together, and then I had a solid piece. And then I did the same thing with the tip. The bird head, I could not get the 3D model to work, so I had to do that old school. Just an MDF, carving it out, and then made molds, and especially for casting the clear parts, like on the beak. But then both these heads are interchangeable on the same wooden shaft. This is Mr. Bushido's mask from Metal Suit Gundam. The client wanted both versions, the full mask and the half mask. So what I did, since they were pretty similar, I took a casting of my own head that I had for other projects, and I used epoxy putty and just sculpted it that way. And did all the cleanup at that stage, made a mold of this piece, made a casting. Or I made 2 castings. One was this, and then for the second casting, I cut away the parts for the half mask, and then I changed, you know, a few details, made the adjustments, so I could basically get 2 props out of one mold. This is a Uruk-hai Berserker helmet from Lord of the Rings. This was made from a 3D model. Exported into a program called Pepakura, which is a paper modeling program. What it does is it takes your geometry and flattens it out, and it gives you all your glue tabs and your fold lines and your cut lines, and you print it out, cut it up, fold it up, glue everything, and you got a little paper model. And then from there, what I did is I just took the liquid plastic and kind of slushed it around on the inside to build up thickness, and then sanded off the paper, and I was good to go. And this was a really quick build. I think it was just thumbtacks for the rivets, and then some little scraps of leather from the fabric store, from the remnants, for the straps. And it's kind of fun doing something where I didn't have to keep everything nice and clean. I just beat the hell out of it, and it didn't matter. It actually helped. This is Claire Redfield's knife from Resident Evil. All these parts, let's see here, the blade, the crossbar, and the texture were laser cut and engraved. There was no way with a Dremel I could go in there and get that design, so I let the laser do the hard work. Then from once I had all the parts assembled, I did half the knife, made a mold, and then I could pop out two copies, glue them together, and call it a day. This is one of my pride and joys. This is my personal project, is the Helm of Sauron. The first part in my eventual building of the entire suit. When I started this, I didn't have much money at the time, so I decided to kind of use waste molds for producing it. The process is basically, I sculpted this out of clay, and once you have that done, you make a plaster mold around it. And once the plaster's set, you pull it off. Of course, what that does is it destroys your clay. So you're all in at that point. You reassemble the plaster mold, you pour in your liquid plastic into the plaster mold, you pull off the plaster. Once again, that destroys the mold. So you got two chances to completely screw it up. Fortunately, everything turned out okay. Of course, I can't make any copies, so people keep asking. This is Ash's hand from Army of Darkness. Most of the parts on this were heat formed, just a heat gun and styrene. The chainmail was a deli meat slicing glove. The finger plates were just, you know, bending heating plastic over a PVC pipe. I did have the little springs 3D printed. And Shapeways now has a service where beyond their basic texture, their basic material, you can pay for a polished version of it. And quite frankly, when I popped open the package, all I had to do was paint them and glue them on. They're perfectly smooth. It's well worth the extra couple bucks as long as you're getting them printed. The forearm, I guess the band brace is just heat bent plastic over a forearm. And then I made the little cocking lever actually spring loaded so it'll move up and down. That's about all it does. And then of course the leather straps hold it on, so to speak. And then that's basically an overview. There's more stuff on the site. If you have any questions, you can contact me at the email address or through Facebook or Twitter. And if you have any questions, you can talk props now.
So you said that you taught yourself. Did you just start out by experimenting with random things, or did you have like a set plan in mind for how you wanted to make, say, your first couple of props?
A lot of it is, you know, I had a background in, you know, building model kits, but nothing from scratch. And then, of course, the first couple projects were all based on tutorials. Generally, if I start a project, I'll look for something similar that someone's done and see how they did it. If it seems like a good idea, I'll give that a go. A lot of it is just, you know, either trial and error, tutorials, going on one of some of the prop boards and just asking a question. You know, if you hit a stumbling block, you post a message saying, I'm trying to do this. This is where I am. Any suggestions? And usually within a few hours, someone's got a solution for you. Yes.
How long did it take for you to build the vacuum form machine?
I've got actually two vacuum formers. The big one that's detailed on the blog probably took about a month. A lot of complicated wiring and math, which I'm no good at either. But online tutorials once again. And probably about $200 of materials. I didn't do as much vacuum forming. I mean, a lot of people, I guess I built it because I thought I would need it, and I didn't need it as much as I thought. If you have a specific project that you really need a vacuum former, that's the time to build it. I've got a small one that I use probably 10 times as much as the big one, and that's, you know, it holds a hobby store 8x10 piece of plastic. You put it in a toaster oven, heat it up, and then you put it on a little tiny vacuum table about this big that hooks up to the shop vac, and that solves most of my problems.
How much did all the materials cost for the tiny one?
For the tiny one, well, I had an old toaster oven, so that was free. Scrap wood, I mean, it's basically building a little vacuum table. If you have any vacuum cleaner at that size will work, even your house one, and you got a hose attachment.
I got a shop vac that I bought from Black Friday.
Okay, yeah, that's more than do the job.
Okay.
So it's very cheap, that's a cheap one to do.
Alright.
Anyone else? Any projects you're working on? Okay, well, I guess that's it.
I'm actually using your tutorial to make the Artemis site for a friend.
Oh, cool.
I've got the foam cut out. It's just, we've been lazy trying to get... I've been trying to get over to my house so we can start working on it, so...
Cool. I'd love to see how that turns out.
Hopefully it'll turn out good.
Good.
I had to drool over your Magic Knight Rayard swords.
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to remake the blue one.
Those are tough.
I noticed.
Yeah, I keep getting asked to build it again. Especially the carving one. It's just crazy.
If you have to do hand carving for like, one of my daughters has a Nagaita that's like 6 feet, and it's supposed to be ice.
Okay.
We did one out of the insulation foam that you get at the at Home Depot. What would be your recommendation to redo it? Because I know I'm going to have to carve it
and
to make it look
supposed
ice.
To look like ice?
Yeah.
Yeah, the only way I can think of to do, you know, something that looks clear is the clear resins, and those are just...
Well, that was kind of what I was thinking I was going to have to go to, because
yeah.
Right now it's the foam and then with blue silvery paint.
Right. You know, how big is it?
About 6 feet.
Yeah, at, you know, at that scale...
Because the Nagaita blade, the top blade, is about this long.
Okay.
And the bottom blade is about this long.
Okay. The problem with the clear resins is that you always get bubbles.
Yeah.
You're either going to get less bubbles or more bubbles, but you're going to get bubbles. And it's such a pain to do, especially the colorant.
Yeah.
And it kicks so quick.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's hardening just almost as soon as you get it in the mold. So there's no time to screw up. You know, at that size, it would take so much resin.
I know. That's kind of why I didn't go with resin in the first place.
You know, unless you do something in plexiglass. You know, get it cut in like, you know, quarter inch plexi. I don't know how thick it is. Is it like a regular sword blade?
Well, it's more rounded.
Okay.
It's from Nuriyon Nomaga, which is just now being dubbed. It's being released in English like in next month or so.
Mm-hmm.
So,
you know, it's possible that what you could do is maybe you could vacuum form it with clear PETG, which the greatest thing about that is you can actually dye it with Ritt dyes.
Oh, okay.
As long as you have something big enough to put it in that you can heat the water to, I think you have to heat the water to 130.
Okay.
You go much hotter than that, you're going to start softening the plastic. But I guess you could dye it first and then vacuum form it. That would work too. And that would give you your curves and your form, and it would be fairly strong.
Okay.
Even at 1/8 inch or 16th inch PETG. Any questions?
Okay.